Welcome and thank you for joining us tonight at the Shrine of Remembrance to celebrate 2017 with an exclusive viewing of the George Vitruv's Victoria Cross Art Exhibition. My name is Matthew Perella and I'm the Associate Partner of Financial Index Wealth Accountants, part of Index, and your host for this evening. The Victoria Cross is the highest award for acts of bravery in wartime. Tonight we'll view portrait paintings of Victoria Cross recipients by acclaimed artist George Vitruv, who also painted the collection of the lost diggers of Ignea Court. George is here tonight, and you'll hear from George later this evening. We are also very honoured to have Victoria Cross recipient Warrant Officer Keith Payne as our guest speaker this afternoon. Keith is the Australian recipient of the Victoria Cross, the highest decoration for gallantry in the face of the enemy. He is the last Australian recipient of the original Imperial Victoria Cross, an iconic Australian and a member of the Order of Australia. Keith's portrait and medals are on display in this evening's collection, and Keith will share some of his story with us tonight. Keith is here with his wife, Lawrence, and we're very honoured to have you here with us. We also have Doug Baird as our other guest speaker this evening. Doug's son, Cameron Baird, VCMG, was an Australian soldier and posthumous recipient of the Victoria Cross of Australia. Cameron was our 100th BC recipient and to date our last. Doug's qualifications are listed as the chairman of CAMS Cause, which is the non-for-profit charity, vice patron of the Australian Bravery Association, vice patron Commando Association of Queensland, ambassador of TPI Victoria, ambassador of Yellow and Black, Australian Military Ribbon, also known as the Anzac Ribbon. Doug is a former Australian rules footballer who played with Carlton in the Victoria Football League. We're also very honoured to have you here with us as well, Doug. Tonight we also have the pleasure of welcoming two sons of two VC recipients. Please welcome Robert Kenner and Barney Limber. We have renowned authors Michael Lariski and Michael Madden here tonight, and we will hear from them shortly. Finally, I would like to acknowledge our CEO, Spiro Paul, and the other senior management team from Findex who are presented here tonight. Findex is Australia's leading provider of integrated financial advisory and accounting services with a vision to revolutionise wealth and empower ambition. We deliver comprehensive advice across the full spectrum of financial services, facilitated through our family office approach. Findex has made this unique event possible this evening. Before I welcome our guests to the stage, I would like to play a short video on the Victoria Cross.
In June this year, my wife and I were among 2,000 people who gathered in Westminster Abbey to celebrate 150 years of Britain's highest gallantry award, the Victoria Cross. The medal was first introduced by my great-great-great-grandmother, Queen Victoria. At that time, there were no gallantry awards available for ordinary soldiers, only for officers. The VC was to be new and different. The Queen insisted from the start that it was a democratic award, available to all regardless of status, rank, or wealth. The inspiration behind the new medal was the campaign that Britain was fighting in the Crimea. It was the first war in history to be widely reported in the newspapers, and it brought the horrors of battle home to the British people. They could see that all soldiers were brave, but wanted rare acts of supreme courage to be recognised further. So, from the beginning, the VC was both exclusive, only for the very brave, and democratic, available to all. It proved popular both with soldiers themselves and with the public. And during Queen Victoria's reign, over 500 VCs were awarded. This film tells the story of the early years of the medal and charts its journey from a new and little-known award for brave British troops to becoming the most famous gallantry award in the world.
Our first speaker this evening, Michael Lariski. Michael was appointed Professor of Commerce at La Trobe University. Having previously published books about economics and finance, Hard Jacker was his first novel, followed up with Return of the Gallipoli Legend, about Australia's famous Victoria Cross recipient, Albert Jacker VC. Please join me in welcoming Michael to the stage.
Thank you very much. And first of all, I'd like to start by just thanking Spiro and Terry Paul for and Findex for this fantastic event that has been going around Australia, and also congratulations to George for an incredible effort for what he's done. So, Albert Jacker VC has taken up the last sort of 20 years of my life, I think. I've written two books about it, about him. I was very fortunate to get General Peter Cosgrove to write the forewords to both books. Return of the Gallipoli Legend talks about Jacker after the war, coming back to Melbourne and his life in Melbourne. So I'll be concentrating more on probably the second book tonight. So this is Wedderburn, about 50 miles north of Bendigo, and this is 1900, and the main street in Bendigo, that's the Carong Mill over there. That burnt down in 1919, but there's three boys here, and there were three boys of roughly the same age in the Jacker family. There was an older one, Sam, but he didn't hang out with the younger boys. Albert was the leader of those younger boys. Here the boys, they never actually got together like this, but their mother had three photographs spliced together. So you had, their mother was Elizabeth, William, Albert and Sydney Jacker, and William and Albert both went onto the Western Front, and Sydney went to Palestine. So I had a friend who had bought a place at Fairhaven, and he was walking past my office, and I said, "Now have a look at this. Where do you think this is? Could it be the Great Ocean Road?" He asked, but no, that is a scene of Anzac Cove and Gallipoli. Around the time that Albert Jacker's VC action, which was at Courtney's Post just up here, and you can see that you know, the ravine there, Monash Gully, and just how precarious it was. It's 1.5 miles from the foremost bit to the beach, not much territory to defend. This is the scene up on Courtney's Post at the time of the VC action. This is the area where the Turks broke through. 40,000 Turks that morning were charging the Australian lines, and the Australians expended 980,000 rounds of ammunition in trying to stop them, and they did stop them. They killed about 7,000 and probably wounded another 14,000 of them. And Albert Jacker, incredibly, held the line for 15 minutes by himself, and later devised a plan where he would go around out into no man's land, jump into the trench behind the Turks, effectively, and then 12 Turks in that trench, and took them on with a bulk action Lee Enfield 303, and killed seven of them and took the whole trench. That was why he was awarded the Victoria Cross. This is a section of that he actually drew by hand himself, showing that the area of trench that the Turks were in was only 22 feet across. So that's after Gallipoli. Albert came back to Egypt with the rest of the men, and he entered an officer training course, came out as a second lieutenant, and then they were off to the Western Front, or off to the Butcher's Picnic, as it was called. Meanwhile, back home, he became a household name, and his image was used in all these recruitment posters and advertising for enlisting men. You know, this sports theme, you know, play up and play the game. Show the enemy what Australian sporting men can do. We're showing that to the English at the moment. So this is it at Pozier Ridge, which is the second action. It is said that if Jacker got a Victoria Cross for the first action, he should have certainly got a Victoria Cross for this action. So the Germans had pounded the lines, they broke through, Jacka effectively charged 85 Germans with seven men. And he was wounded seven times in the engagement. He accounted for about 15 Germans himself. It was, again, an amazing action that should have earned a Victoria Cross. This is a sort of an artist's impression of what it was like when he was doing it. This is Boulecourt in France, which was another area where Jacka excelled. He broke through, well, he broke through the lines and was able to survey the German defences. It was a disaster for the Australians because they relied on tanks. The tanks broke down and were bombed out of existence. And it was a disaster for the 4,000 Australians who participated in the action. But again, Jacka probably should have got something there, apart from a military cross. The impact of war, they both started on the left, Albert and Bill, his brother, because their father was on the left. And he was against the conscription, in the conscription debate, he was against conscription. But Albert actually sort of went on the side of the officers during the war and became more right-wing. I wouldn't say that he was extreme right, but he was right-wing. His brother went left, and he started from the left, so he went sort of extreme left. And later on, he became the mayor of Footscray. Albert became the mayor of St Kilda, which is sort of opposite extremes. And about a month after Bill became the mayor of St Kilda, the red flag went up on the town hall. So this is a third battle that I'll just give a few brief details about. But Jacka, extraordinary action at Polygon Wood. Probably should have been awarded a DSO, a Distinguished Service Order, there for the leadership that he showed as an officer. The DSO was for officers only. An amazing contribution. Took command of the whole battalion because they lost contact with their colonel, and saved numerous lives with his bravery and his tactical genius. This is him after the war. He was actually gassed in May 1918 at Villa Bretonneau and was sent back to England again. So for the third time, wounded the third time and sent back to England. This time they didn't send him back. And for about a year he stayed in England as a sports officer and came back in October 1919. And this is Albert at Port Melbourne, which we talked about just before the thing, all these people coming to Port Melbourne. His nemesis was General Brand, and he ended up meeting him at the dock. He just couldn't get rid of General Brand, both at the war and afterwards. So here we have an interesting photograph, because this is in Rose Street, North Fitzroy. I had a huge argument with the lady that lives there now because she wouldn't believe me that is the actual house that belonged to the Waldrons. And there's Albert, that's his mother Elizabeth, that's his brother Sydney, his auntie and uncle, his sister, and there's no father. And you'd think after 5 years, this great hero, it was an embarrassment because his father had gone on to the anti-conscription debate. And so it was probably a bit embarrassing for him to have been there at that time. So the thing about the war was that it did split families like that. It split Australia and it split families. This is a caricature of John Wren, who is another interesting character that Jacka had a relationship with. Wren decided to back Jacka into a business. He actually backed a number of people into businesses. The interesting thing there as well was in those days, given that Jacka was an Anglican and Wren was a very outstanding Catholic and sort of Irish as well as Australian patriot. This was an unusual situation in those times. And that's what made Jacker actually very interesting to me, is because he did this kind of thing in those days. Their business started up at 475 Collins Street in the Alderfleet building on the third floor there. They did all right for a while during the 1920s. He did very well here with Francis Veronica Carey, because they advertised in the Alderfleet building, they advertised for a secretary. Apparently she walked in one day for the interview saw the lift was open and sort of just walked into the lift, and she happened to be there ready for the interview going up. And she asked him, are you Albert Jacker? And he said yes, and she immediately sort of planted a kiss on him and said, you are my hero as I was growing up. She was about 20 years old at the time. And 8 months later they got married. And that was interesting too, because you see, she was Catholic, right? And if you look at all the records and you see, there is no record of, in the media at all, of their wedding. And here's the greatest Aussie hero of World War I. And there's no record whatsoever, because the family didn't even turn up, because they were Anglicans, to the Catholic Church. And the best man ended up being Vera's 18-year-old brother. Imagine how many men were lining up for that role. So there's Albert now at the spot. You saw that Corong Mill earlier on? Well, that is exactly the spot where the Corong Mill used to be located, and he's now giving a speech at the opening of the Soldiers Memorial Park, which is now Jacker Park in Wedderburn. Just some advertising when they were still in Briscoe Lane, just behind where the old headquarters of ANZ in Queen Street. Just behind that is Briscoe Lane, and there's a plaza there. Well, that where that plaza is, that's where his business was located. But they then moved it later on. Albert Jacker was hugely interested in maintaining memory about the war and the sacrifice of the diggers. And he was out nights with the PowerPoint of the day, which was lantern slides, which he used to borrow from the Australian War Memorial, which was just down the street because it was in Nicholson Street. Right? That was where the Australian War Memorial got started in 1923. So he was out telling that story to whoever would listen. And so many, you see dotted through newspaper advertisements for Captain Jacker will speak, etc., etc. So here he's addressing the Advertising Institute in April 1927, which was just around the time that fateful meeting took place at Anzac House in Collins Street in 1927, where Monash got up at the meeting and said, the best place for the shrine is at the Domain. And 32 Victoria Cross recipients who were sitting at the table all immediately rose and gave him a standing ovation. The RSL had already actually backed another plan, which was to demolish a couple of, where the Imperial Hotel is in front of Parliament House, right? They were going to demolish a couple of parts of the block and make an Anzac Square there. So that plan was then just scotched by this one event at this meeting. They couldn't have natural children, so they adopted a daughter who was adopted from a digger family as well. Elizabeth, she was named after Queen Elizabeth, by the way. So 1926, it was popular then, she's sort of coming on 92 now. Very feisty. I have about 2.5 years of email correspondence with this young girl, and she was very, very adamant about things. But she likes both books, by the way. So here's the business that they then got into, because they then sort of expanded, and they've got this sort of bigger place here in Elizabeth Street. Downstairs here is a Subway store right now. Okay, so that's a Subway. Office Works is just down here, and across the road is the Block Arcade entry. So that's where his business was when it went down the tubes in 1929, with £20,000 of outstanding creditors. So I could then never work out, you know, why he didn't lose his house, you know, having sort of racked up this bill. And I got to the bottom of it by actually getting in touch with the National Australia Bank's archivist, got them to go into the minute books, and they pulled out the minute book for the dates that I gave them, and out came the board minutes, which said that, guess what, John Redd just paid for it all. Right? So John Redd just covered him completely and protected him in that way. And one, you know, £20,000 in those days, I mean, a house was £1,500, a good house was £1,500. So that was a fair amount of money. Yeah, this was the closing down sales. They were sort of starting to reduce prices on everything. So here is an interesting case, because he became, luckily he was sort of saved at the time, because suddenly he was out on the street, and from being this, you know, prosperous businessman, he's suddenly on the street, and he was on the council of the St Kilda Council at the time, and they voted him in as the mayor, which gave him £500 for the year and the use of a car, the mayor's car. Well, he actually didn't take the car up, he actually gave that to the unemployed so that they could use it to find jobs. And he did all sorts of things like that, an amazing man. But he also arranged, while he was mayor, for the colours of the 14th Battalion to be brought in to the foyer of the St Kilda Town Hall, where they still are, there above the doors as you go into the main hall. So he arranged it all, and then they printed a book about the council, and they had this historic photograph here. And of course, there you have Albert Jacka, and in uniform. And I see this little girl here. And when I first saw this, I thought, is that his daughter, Elizabeth? I mean, I sent this photo to her and had a correspondence with her. She goes, no, that's not me. I was never there. I don't believe that is the case. The hair is the wrong colour, etc. So it can't be me. Anyway, I then sort of found the actual original photo, and guess what? There's no Albert Jacka. And they talk about fake news today, but it's been around for a while. So that's an interesting sort of juxtaposition. Here he is and here he isn't. But it's a fantastic photograph. That photograph, I don't know how many pixels it's got in it, but it's amazing, because I have delved into that photograph. It's like time travel. You know, it's unbelievable. Here's Albert Jacka with his mentor, Councillor Burnett Gray. And I don't know if you've, in Elwood, in the boulevard in Elwood, have you ever driven down the boulevard, that beautiful street with the plane trees all over it. A bit further down there is a little Burnett Gray Child Minding Centre. Whenever I drive past that, I think of him. He was an amazing man too. He was ahead of his time, and he influenced Jacka in a sort of free market type of approach, because when it came, for example, oh, by the way, they were both Freemasons as well, and you know, I did mention at one of my talks that here they were sort of shoulder to shoulder, elbow to elbow, knee to knee, toe to toe type of thing. Turns out that is a Mason type of, Freemason type of thing. In fact, after the talk, I got the handshake from one of the people that was there. Here's Vera as the Lady Mayoress. And that last year that they were together as the Mayor and Lady Mayoress was incredible strain on the two of them. I think they'd had strain all the way through, because he was this incredible hero. He had this, I think he had a guilt complex that he made it through all of that. Unbelievable. And he was trying to pay back. It wrecked their marriage. and she left him. Anyway, here we have something that's also familiar to people. I mean, these turrets here, you know, that's the baths, the St Kilda Baths, which was sort of put in 1931. While Albert Jacka was the mayor, he actually voted against this project being funded by the council. Bernard Gray and he, together, said, no, we need a public-private partnership. We need to have user pays. We need to get someone to build it privately. We'll control the prices, but people who come will pay, because we've got a Great Depression going on. Why should we burden the people of St Kilda who don't want to be using that pool right now? But then when he came in, so they lost the vote narrowly, and then so they then spent £45,000 building it, and he had to oversee the project as the mayor. And here, what happened then was that suddenly he contracted acute nephritis, a kidney condition, which killed him at the age of 39. He probably looked about 60 at the time, but he was 39 years old. And often it's said that this was because of his war service and all that, and of course a lot of sort of propagandistic hoo-ha was made about that during the time that they were raising money for Vera's house, because they did buy Vera a house. £1,500 was raised in like 3 or 4 days by the Herald and the Sun. But you can imagine that day when they walked in here, 3 months before this scene. Vera had walked out. She'd got a job in the city, because that was one thing. Women couldn't walk out in those days because they couldn't get a job. But she, being who she was, could get a job. She was the hostess at the Hotel Australia of the Venetian Room. So he's suddenly struck down by this illness. He's lying in one of these beds. And on the Sunday lunchtime, she walks in with her 5-year-old daughter. And so Elizabeth told me that when she walked into that room, she could still remember it now, the daggers looking at her mother and her. And she was lifted up to the Father. Anyway, Vera was there in the last minutes of his life, and he passed. This day that was his funeral was like 108 degrees. There were fires all around Melbourne. 50,000 people came, dressed in suits. They 800 of his digger mates marched behind him. And they marched past the shrine being built, which he had on countless occasions raised money for at functions. Jacko will be speaking function to raise money for the shrine. And was laid to rest in St Kilda. And there we have General Grant. And there's Vera, and there's Elizabeth, just looking at the unveiling of that monument, which actually incredibly looks down the street that he lived in with Vera during the best years of her life, which was very short. Examining that life, you just think life can be very short. So I'll probably leave it at that point, but thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michael, for an amazing insight into an exceptional Australian. I would now like to welcome to the stage Keith Payne and Doug Bedd, but before we do, we have another short video here which Doug has provided to us.
The play spoke of making the best of tests, of learning lessons and having the time of your life. My name is Cameron Baird, and the greatest lesson I ever learned, which lent me strength for the hardest tests, was to stand together as a team. That gave me the time of my life. Toward the end, my team were the Army brothers I fought and died for, the incredible boys of the 2nd Commando Regiment, Australian Special Forces. But in the broader sense, from my early days, I was taught to stand by everyone. You see, when I was a nipper, Mum and Dad reckoned I could aspire to be anything. The best sportsman, the best soldier, the best damn guitar player on the planet. But if, and only if, I had the help of others. I first saw this on the footy field, where the awards that mattered the most were earned by the team. Yes, I received a few of my own, but the biggest buzz was always gained when all of us achieved. Without my mates, I might not have won any awards, and those I did wouldn't have meant as much to me. That's why I hardly ever wore my medal for gallantry. Because although it mattered dearly, I also believe it belonged to the team. They were at my side, and they had my back when our mate Luke was killed, and we charged the guns to rescue him. From then on, I tried to be first through every door, through every room of every house, until I died 6 years later. Mum and Dad received my Victoria Cross. The citation said, I charged my last compound on 3 separate occasions, that I cleared my rifle when it jammed and kept on going through my last door, where I fell, neutralising the enemy. The one word they could have added was, we. As we did with Luke Worsley, I knew my brothers were at my side, that they would lay down their lives for me, just as I laid down my life for them, the team. They would bear me home, queuing up to carry me like we carried Luke, completely knackered after 12 hours of fighting. They would gather together afterwards to laugh, to cry, and to sing. Together, we made the best of the tests. We learnt the lessons, and we had the time of our lives without warning. My name is Cameron Baird, VC, MG, Commando, one of the team. Cameron's history was read with pride by his brother Brendan, with the blessing of his mum and dad, Kay and Doug.
Term
from Vietnam on Monday. Can you tell us why you were there?
Yes, that's a good question. Good evening, folks. Later in the evening, I've been asked to let you know that after Doug completes his great tale, and it's not a tale, it's a very moving thing, right? So that there will be a time set aside for questions for Doug and myself. Now, to answer the question while I was there, why I was in Vietnam again this year, I've been back three times now for the sole purpose of looking for my brother company commander's remains that I had to leave in the field that night. It was my responsibility on that occasion to say yes, we will be leaving the body in the field. I had asked for permission by radio through aircraft and everywhere else to get a helicopter in with a Maguire rig, and I'd gone forward to find a hole in the canopy which we could extract Montez from. We were thinking about Jerry Delroe, my American Special Forces medic, who was with me on all of my operations, to say, well, will he survive the lift out and the journey back to Duck Tow, or will we say no and we'll take the chance of getting him in from here? The whole thing that happened on that night was the fact that we had so many wounded and everything, and to carry the big man, and he was a big man, was becoming, and through the terrain that we were travelling, was becoming a little bit arduous. So having called for the helicopter with a Maguire rig to lift him out, I went back to Jerry, the medic, and he told me that Monty had passed. So I checked that out myself, and then I jumped on the radio and asked for permission to, I told him that Monty had passed, and I'd asked for permission to leave the body and return to base before later recovery of Montez. It was my decision at that time. It was my responsibility. I was the company commander. I was leading the group, and it hurts me still to have to say that, well, I had to make the final decision of leaving the body there. But under the circumstances, and Jerry and quite a lot of the people that were around at that time said, okay, Keith, don't worry about it, you did the right thing. So I went back to Vietnam, this time with Jerry. He came from Spokane, Washington, and in the US. And once again, we foraged around in the area where we had left Montez, to try and find some remnants of remains of his body. We did have found American buckles of their equipment, our ammunition, and unfortunately some of the casings from the enemy's ammunition. So this was my last hurrah. We went back, Jerry and I said, well, we won't be able to do it again. However, somebody was there and has done a research on the whole operation and everything, and has asked Jerry and I if we could see our way clear to go back and just sit on the hill and talk to a group of Australian military buffs, and I'm going to speak to Brendan Nelson about it and hope that he will lead the party. There'll only be a party about four or five, and they will go through the battle scene, and then go down into the area where we had left Montez, and hopefully they can find something. So that's why I was in Vietnam this time, apart from the fact that I wanted to take my wife, not up into that area, but just into the country, because it's a beautiful country. The people are beautiful and they've changed. They've all like Australians again. So we're in the right criteria. Thank you.
And I also understand that you were awarded your Victoria Cross in unique circumstances. Are you able to elaborate on that for us?
Well, very quickly, the Queen was coming out to Australia to visit Australia in 1970. She was on board Britannia. It docked at Hamilton Wharf in Brisbane. I trottled on board with my family, and I was invested on board. So, a great time, the only time that ever happened, an investiture of the Victoria Cross in Queensland, and certainly the only one that happened on board the Britannia. The highlight of this, of course, was the next day when we were in a receiving party of all these officials, and my wife was standing there, and the Queen came along, and she said hello to us, and she started to move on, and she turned back and she said to my wife, Flo, she said, and of course we will see you on board for lunch tomorrow. And I said, Flo, okay, so that's the story where the investiture took place on board Britannia in Brisbane.
Thanks, Keith. And just finally, you must see a lot of damaged veterans whilst touring around Australia. Do you feel that as a nation we're doing enough?
Oh, my friend the DVA. I told the group yesterday about my project of the 2359 project, and it is taking shape. The Chief of Army has told me that we're 80% down along that track, and we have 20% to go, and so 80% at this time is pretty good considering the time factor. But I'd like to see it, of course, all done, and then it would cut down. What really disturbs me is the suicide rate, unfortunately, of our veterans. And if we can cut that down and eliminate it, I'd feel so proud to have something to do with that job.
Thank you very much, Pete. And Doug, a few questions for yourself. It must be difficult to be continually asked the same questions about Cameron. How do you do it?
Look, it's now been a few years, and the questions are relevant because people want to know. And I guess as a family, we're now at a point where we realise Cameron's not going to walk through that door. It's taken a long time, and it hasn't been easy, but by talking about it, it gives us an opportunity to talk about other things as well. Our focus now is not primarily on Cameron. Cameron's very much well known. We've heard about Albert, and you may have seen the coins that came out of collection about 8 or 9 months ago. It was called the Heroes of Anzac, and there was 12 coins in that particular collection, and every coin had a story and a photograph of the person that had been a recipient of that. And on the Victoria Cross, there was 2 photos. What were the 2 photos? One, of course, was Cameron, and the other one was Albert Jacka. So you can read in whatever you think about that. we talk about modern day soldiers, we talk about matesmanship, and it hasn't changed. We fight wars these days in a different way that we used to fight them when Albert fought them. And it's one of those sort of things that we just now accept that it is what it is, and we are able to talk about different little odds and ends that's going to benefit. And what Keith has just touched about is that our focus now is towards raising money through CAMS Cause to support programs like Keith's, to support program that Two Commando run. Two Commando over the last 10 to 12 years is the highest decorated regiment in the Australian Army, but they've paid a very heavy price with over 10 or 12 soldiers killed and well over 100 seriously wounded or injured. So that's where our focus is, and that's what we talk about mainly now. And we love talking to school children about it. And we like talking to this group, and we'll consider you guys school children too.
Thanks, Keith. Also, Doug. Now, you were an Aussie rules footballer yourself for Carlton, and I believe Cameron was a rising star. Are you able to talk about his sporting achievements with us?
Yeah, that's pretty easy. And to be perfectly honest, my football days are so insignificant and it really shouldn't be brought up. But unfortunately, when Cameron was awarded the Victoria Cross, press tend to dig into the background. And when they found out that I had played AFL football, they swung that way. But look, Cameron was a 10 times better footballer than myself. Cameron was 6'4", over 100 kilos, but he had the ability to be able to do almost anything. He was an Australian discus champion. He was a Victorian shot put champion. And really, technically, shouldn't have been in the Army because he should have been drafted into the AFL. He received two letters from AFL clubs saying they were going to draft him, but in his last year of under 18 football with the TAC Calder Cannons, he received a very severe shoulder injury, which basically was almost a reconstruction. In actual fact, when he actually applied for Army had knocked him back and said, "You're not medically fit, you won't be able to survive and do what a soldier does." He proved him wrong. But Cameron's sporting ability is well known, and it was one of the things that drove him to the Army, because I think he thought that he needed a new challenge. His sporting days were done and dusted, and when he joined the Army, he never played football again.
Now, I believe you're heavily involved in CAMS Cause, and we've touched on that tonight. Can you tell us a bit more about it and also ways that we can support?
Yeah, look, that's one of great pride for the family. It's CAMS Cause was, it came about by just a chance meeting between Cameron's primary school teacher, Mr. Andrew Harrison, and a grade 4 and grade 5 student. They decided that what they'd like to do is to have a function in honour of Cameron to see whether they could raise a couple of $1,000 and pass it on to a military charity of some description. They ran that particular night, they closed the doors at 275 due to health reasons, and they raised in excess of $30,000. And that was the start of CAMS Cause. And within about 5 days, that money was transferred over to the Commando Welfare Trust. And CAMS Cause in general now deals both with the Commando Welfare Trust, deals directly with 2nd Commando Regiment through their wellness camps, and where we supply money to be able to get professionals in when they go away for a weekend. We supply fishing rods, we supply canoes, we supply surfboards, we pay for the accommodation. That's the sort of thing that CAMS Cause does now. And we also supply information, as in military, in regard to plaques for schools, particularly primary schools, so they can get a better education. So CAMS Cause at the moment is running at a really nice little pace to help our veterans out. And one of the ways that, you know, you guys tonight can actually help CAMS Cause is by buying one of the books. One of the books are for sale. I think there's only about 50 of them out there. There could be a couple more. But if you want to support our current vets, all the money goes to them. So that's the story of CAMS Cause, and we're so proud that we're able to uphold his legacy and do the things that if he was alive today, he would be doing them, not us.
Thanks, Doug. And in Cameron's book, there's a few references to AC/DC. Are you able to explain to us your interest, CAMS' interest, and maybe even the recent Sydney Findex experience with the band?
Look, that's a funny story, because very early in Cameron's life, particularly in grade four, I think was the first time he went to an AC/DC concert. And yes, I'm responsible for it, because through my playing days, I had great connections and people had super boxes, and we went along to the first AC/DC concert. And I think probably since grade four, he probably attended about seven, of which I attended about six with him as well. So, but look, we had a wonderful experience at the Findex, these two shows we've done in Sydney. We were talking about this, and all of a sudden, there was a gentleman come forward out of the crowd. And that man's name was Mark Evans, not only a one-eyed Carlton supporter, but he was the original bass player in AC/DC before they actually split up. And we told the story, and that was the experience we had at Sydney. And that's the story. So if people want to blame somebody, they've got to blame his father on that one.
Now, something a little bit different to last night. We've been fortunate enough to open up the floor for some Q&A time for both Doug and Keith. So at this point, we're more than happy to open up the floor. If anyone has any questions that they'd like to ask, these two gentlemen have been more than happy to oblige.
Look, Keith and I have spoken about this before. Keith and I do a lot of shows together and do different things, and there's nothing that we can't answer. Don't be scared to ask anything of myself in regard to my son or his death. And I'm sure Keith, as he opened his heart, what he had to do on the battlefield all those years ago and leave his mate there. So, look, if there's something you would like to ask, please do so and don't hold anything back. This is what grade four and grade five students do. It only takes one to get going, and once you get one, hello, we've got Mr. Madden there.
Just if you ask Keith, when he found out about his award with and Simo's involvement.
When you found out about UPC and Simo's involvement with it, he said, "Oh, sorry.
I never got that. Have to tell me loudly. Have to tell me loudly, Doug."
When you found out about your VC, you found out about the VC and Ray Simpson was with you?
That was in Saigon. strange things happen, the best thing that happened after they had gathered all the media and everything in Saigon, Simo grabbed me and took me aside, and just strange things happen. Suddenly, out of nowhere, popped two cold beers. So Chutter, or Simo's, most of you know anyway, made sure that I had a settling time after the announcement of my award. It was quite a surprise, and I won't tell you what I said to General Hay in his office, because there's ladies present. But it was quite a shock. And I accepted the award on behalf of my soldiers. It wasn't just me that night, I can assure you. It was a lot of other people were all involved, and it was a mess. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the floor?
Yes, there's one there. Kate.
Doug, what do you and your family do each year to mark the anniversary of Cam's death?
We just have a very quiet day. We visit the cemetery, of course. Just sit there. That's about it. Sorry, I can't answer any more than that.
Question just up here to the left, Bobby.
Keith, it's obviously a cause of yours, but what more does the department and the government need to do for return servicemen?
What he's asking is, it's obviously, what more does DBA and government have to do for our veterans?
Oh! Okay, people. That's a fine question. If you didn't hear it, it is basically the question is, what more can the military and DVA do for the veteran community? And I would also like to ask you, as a group, and some veterans sitting amongst you, right? When you see a veteran or when you see a digger in uniform, just say, thank you for your service. It will mean so much, truly. Now, what can the department or Defence Department do? The Defence Department, the program that I had put in place is two sections. Basically, one is what is required of the Defence Department to look after the proposed veteran that is going out of service. The other is where DVA fits in on the other half of the page. The Defence Department's responsibility is to A, put the soldier, male or female, they're all soldiers, have a look at the dictionary and it will tell you, where's the uniform of the nation. Now, what they have to do is keep them in uniform and make sure that they have all of the tests that they had to have when they enlisted. The military made sure that they were damn well fit enough to be in the military before they went into the military. Let the military now say, okay, before we let you out of the uniform, we're going to make sure that you get all of the entitlements through the Department of Veterans Affairs that represent the veterans of the nation to make sure that they are well looked after, and as a consequence, it radiates to the family. Now, I spoke earlier about the reason for this, the reason, and I said to the Chief of Staff, and, you know, I don't talk to officers too greatly, however, I said to him, who is committing these deaths? I said, and I pointed to him and I said, you are. You are letting the veteran, the soldier, out of uniform, right? Letting them fight DVA for 18 months, 2 years for their entitlements. And consequently, at the end of the term, most of them are committing suicide. And it is our job, all of us, our job to ensure that the nation looks after its veteran community. And if you're talking to a politician, just mention, hey, I hope you people are still looking after the veterans. That will just let them know that you are interested in the veteran community. So once again, yes, there's a lot to be done. I'm striking things all the time. Doug's striking things all the time. We have organisations of soldier on. Doug's got his commando welfare thing and the commando association where the veterans are looking after the veterans. We have the RSL, which is unfortunately in a little bit of a turmoil at the moment, but it was looking after the veteran community. Now the other organisations are taking over that role particularly. So once again, I can just ask you, if you see a vet or a digger in uniform, just say thank you for your service. Thank you.
Now, before we
let these two fine gentlemen off the stage, I believe you've got a presentation that you'd like to make there.
Yeah, look, I have, but if I may just take 1 minute, this journey's been a long one. I actually attended with George the very first Findex VC display paintings up at Innisfail. George and I flew to Cairns, we drove down to Innisfail, and George spoke in glowing terms about Findex, and I thought to myself, it probably can't be quite right. So in the process of that drive there, I actually asked the questions, and I asked the hard questions, and as I have come and I've now done four, five shows, I've found out Findex has got absolutely outstanding leaders with Spiro and Terry leading the show with magnificent management. They're an operation or a company that not only looks after their staff and shows respect to them, but they love their customers. And I've seen that. If you've been to a town where there's 55 people attending and they hang off absolutely every word, they are so devoted and it works in a reciprocal sort of way. The customers love Findex, and Findex loves you guys as well. So I would like to take this opportunity to perhaps ask if Terry can come forward. And I'd like to make a little presentation to him.
Mm-hmm. You got it right.
Good.
Look, Terry, thank you very much.
Madden. A lifetime of writing has seen the production of four novels and many short stories. Michael is a multi-award winning writer, Australian military history, medal mounting, and the Victoria Cross rifled Michael towards what has become his flagship work, the Victoria Cross, Australian Remembers. The book publication date is set for release in April 2018. Please make him feel welcome, Michael Madden.
First of all, thank you. That's a pretty hard act to follow, you two blokes, but I'll do my best. And I just would like to just echo Doug's words. I've done, I think, four or five of these shows with George around Australia, and I agree with every word you said, mate. Findex are a very unique company, to say the least, and I'm humbled and very grateful for the opportunity you've given me to share with everybody what we're doing, so thank you. As was said, I'm an author. I'm working on the current project you see up there, the Victoria Cross Australia Remembers. That's sort of what the book is going to look like, more or less. It's due for publication. Actually, we're releasing it on the 21st of April next year. The idea of the book was to photograph every set of medals, every statue, every grave and every monument that we could find for Australia's 100 Victoria Cross recipients, and to write a short story about each one of them. When I came up with the idea, I had no idea what I was getting myself into. It turns out that covers 17 countries around the world, places like Russia, Kenya, Libya, Egypt. These men are buried everywhere. And it gives you a really good indication of the service that this country has given over the last 100 or so years. And in the beginning, I thought if I could find perhaps 20 families to speak to, being families of Victoria Cross recipients, that would be a great achievement, because there is no register or there's no record of where all these families are. Nobody knew them. The War Memorial couldn't really help. So I thought 20 would be outstanding. We finished the book last week. It's now in print. We're working with the editors, and I can confirm that we ended up with 59 families involved in the book, which was extraordinary. Men like Doug, the VC recipients themselves, Keith, who spoke to Flo, it was just a remarkable journey. And what was clear to me was that this book needed to be not for profit. Given it the subject matter, I didn't think it was right that I should take money for it. So it came down to basically picking a charity, and the charity that I picked was the TPI Association of Victoria. When I say I, actually, it was my dad's decision. TPI is totally and permanently incapacitated ex-servicemen and women. My dad is a TPI Vietnam veteran. He's totally and permanently incapacitated from his service during that war. And the association has done more for my family than I can possibly put in words. Dad's going through an awful time at the moment. And TPI have once again risen to the surface in a way that has my family completely gobsmacked. So the decision there was clearly right. And also, I'd just like to thank a few people here who have just recently come on as ambassadors for TPI. There's a few of them in this room. First of all, Keith and Flo Payne, Doug Baird, and we have Rick Meehan and Fred Campbell down the front here. They're now new ambassadors. George Petru was made patron of the association. And we also had Ross Coulthard from 60 Minutes and the fella from ACDC that Doug was talking about as well. Mark Evans came on board, which is extraordinary. They've never had patrons before, so we're trying to develop and get the word out there, and that's what we're all about. So this might prompt you to ask why. Why the Victoria Cross? What's so special about it? As was touched on earlier in Prince Charles's video, it is the highest award for valour that anybody can receive. Still there? This happened last night, we lost it, so just keep your fingers crossed. The award came about during the Crimean War in the 1850s, where the English were fighting with the French. And the French had the French had this award here, the French Legion of Honour, and the British commanders noticed them handing this out to pretty much anybody. The British had nothing like it. All they had was the Order of the Bath and orders like that, which could only be given to officers. The NCRs, the enlisted men, got nothing. Perhaps they might be promoted in the field or mentioned in dispatches. They liked the idea. So they put it to the Queen, Queen Victoria, you can see here working on her diaries, and she absolutely loved the idea. And once she threw her weight behind it, no pun there, there was no stopping it. She had a very good understanding of what the men were doing and what they were going through, and we've lost it again. This happened last night, Thursday. Hopefully somebody can fix that, but I'll just travel on without it. So the idea basically was to create the Victoria Cross from bronze. Bronze from captured cannons. Legend tells us that these cannons were captured during the Crimean War at Sebastopol. And I have a lovely picture of them here in front of me that I want to show you. Trust me, it looks really nice. Unfortunately, the legends aren't quite true. The cannon were not Russian and were almost certainly never anywhere near Sebastopol. They were Chinese, like everything else. So, Keith, your VC is made in China. Made in London, but the metal comes from China. And they weren't melted down either. What they did is they took the castabel off the back of one of the cannons. The castabel is the rear part of the cannon, which they used to secure ropes to. The ropes would control the cannon's enormous recoil. So they took that off, they slice it down, and every time they go to make them, they melt down that metal. So it's actually parts of the castabel that are used. There's still a piece of it about the size of a head that's left, and that is the metal that all VCs are made from. Now that metal is held in a military base in Shropshire in England. We're back.
Bangkok.
And there's my can. Okay. Thank you. Now this is all that's left of that metal, and that's the castable at the back, and that's the cannon that it came off. There's two of these. That's all that remains. There's enough there, I'm told, for about another 88 VCs. And that's held in the most extreme security you could imagine. It's in a military base in the UK where they house all their weapons, and it's inside a vault. Inside the vault, it's inside a safe. Inside that safe, which is alarmed, it's inside a wooden box which has a padlock on it. And interestingly, when I got there, the padlock wasn't locked. We had the absolute honour of being the first Australians ever in the vault, and I got to hold that piece of metal, myself and Gordon Trail, across the room there. And we photographed it and filmed it, and it's featured in the book. And that was with permission from Her Majesty, obviously, because it's her property. Now, all VCs are made by Hancocks, who are a small jeweller in London. This is just in a little arcade in London, they're very small. When the VC was being created, Hancocks were only 7 years old. They were silver workers at the time. And they had already gained such a high reputation that they won the tender for it, and they've made every VC since. That book there is the book of VC records. Every VC that's made, including Keith's and everybody else's, it has a series of secret marks put on the back. And those marks are recorded in the book, along with the man's name, the date, the citation. And the idea of that is because they've become so valuable, and this was great forward thinking in 1856 to start doing this, that someone from Hancock's can go to auction and vet the metal, prove that it is the actual original cross. And all that information was in that book, which I was allowed to read through, which was great fun, but obviously we weren't allowed to photograph the inside of it. Now when the Hancock's came up with the idea, they made a prototype VC, that's this here. And now this was sent to Queen Victoria in 1856 for her to approve it. It was made from copper, I believe, not brass, just being because it was a prototype. And she loved it. The only change, this is a real one here on the right. The only changes she made, as you can see here, she added some laurel leaves and this little V for Victoria. And that's it. She didn't touch it. She just said that it had to be bronze. She didn't like the way that looked. She thought on a blue jacket it would look awful. And now before then she'd also intervened in the wording. The original wording was going to be for the brave. Her Majesty didn't like that. She thought it suggested that the only brave men in her forces were VC recipients. So she changed the wording for valour, and that's why it says for valour to this day. Now, the VCs, being as they're made from basically rubbish bronze, recycled bronze, Hancock's had all sorts of problems when they were trying to cast them or strike them. The casts kept, the moulds kept breaking because the bronze was so hard. So they had to sand cast these metals and hand chase, which means they have to finish them by hand. As you can see here, this is the first Victoria Cross ever awarded to an Australian, that's Sir Neville House. And these are Cameron Baird's original VCs. And to give you an idea of how they've changed, this is a World War II VC, this is, World War I, beg your pardon, that's actually Martin O'Neill, it's that man over there. And this is a World War II one. You can see the differences in the main, quite dramatic differences, and in the crown where there's dots, and here there's lines. So you can see they do change over the years, and this is because they're made in batches of about 12, and then again hand finished obviously by different men, because this has been going on for over about 160 years. So it's interesting to see the differences. Now getting back to that prototype, I was invited by Her Majesty to go into Windsor Castle, to hold that prototype in my hands, and that was an honour. And it's the property of the family, and it's something they take very, very seriously. And So we got in there and we got to hold the prototype cross. For a tragic like me, it was a moment I'll never forget. It's part of the process of the book, obviously, photographing the graves as well as the medals. A lot of travel was involved. We do have all the shots. We didn't make it to all the countries being a charity, but we worked with other charities and we got the job done. We went to the Western Front. The battlefield you see on the right there, the graveyard on the right, that's Polygon Wood. It was a great experience. My grandfather was shot behind these trees here. There's a place called Scott's Post. He was the date Michael was talking about, the 26th of September, where Jacka should have received probably another Victoria Cross, is the day my great grandfather was shot taking Scott's Post. The pillbox behind those trees, if you ever go there, go and have a look, it's still there. And went with George and we got to see there and stand there. He survived, obviously, because I'm here. So there's some of the things we got to do. And we took with us, well, I took with me a replica Victoria Cross. Now, this is made by Hancock's in London. It's a real Victoria Cross for all intents and purposes. It's just made from different metal, not the metal I showed you before, but the closest bronze they could find to that metal. The box that comes in is real. It's basically a real VC. And we took that everywhere with us and we popped it on the guys' graves. A lot of the 59 or so families you'll see in the book actually hold this VC in the book, so it was featured very, very heavily throughout. And it's a bit of a surprise I've got it here tonight. So you're all welcome to come up later and have a look and have a look at and see what it's all about. That's basically it. Oh, and I should say also on that trip, the wives, my mother and her friend made some woolen poppies which we laid on the graves of all the Victoria Cross recipients that we went to visit over there. We hit 22 sites in 3 days. It wasn't a holiday, but it was a whirlwind trip. And this was done by the wives of TPI veterans to thank the VC families for helping in the book, and we did live broadcasts for the families from each grave, and we laid those poppies there. And I've had people, one lady went there that I worked with last week and said they're all still there, so that's really good. So that's what we're all about. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael. I would now like to introduce the artist, George Pitcher, who has spent significant time researching World War I soldiers and the Victoria Cross recipients both in Australia and overseas, and is heavily involved in the Victoria Cross Australia Remembers, soon to be released and just discussed by Michael. Findex is proud to present tonight's presentation. This is the second time that both Findex and George have collaborated together to deliver an inspiring travelling exhibition like this. Please welcome George to the stage.
What a great place for a grand finale tonight, the Shrine. Perfect location, could wish for anything better. So thank you for providing that Findex. It's been wonderful. It's a bit sad for me. It's our last trip. I think we've done 13 shows already. As Doug mentioned, we started off in Innisfail, and that was quite a long time ago. But it was great to go out and visit some of these regional towns. Was a great experience for me. I wasn't sure how they were going to go, but we even managed to. We actually started off in Innisfail, and then we sort of worked our way down to Townsville, where we had Flo and Keith do our second show, which was really special. Then we sort of went a little bit further down. Except we'll give you an overview of what we did, because you probably don't know where we've sort of been, so I'll do it very quickly, and I know we're running behind time-wise. So after Townsville, we drop into Coffs Harbour with Jim Claven, and that we actually had our show in an above ground bunker, which was very unusual. That was really, really terrific. Then we did some New South Wales regional locations. We went to Dubbo, we went to Bathurst, went to Orange, and went to a place that I've never heard of, West Wylong. And that was great, because there was the son of Reg Racky VC, and he was good enough to bring his VC along with him, and he's a very casual sort of character, as we know, and as Michael Mann alluded to, he's a pretty laid-back sort of guy, so he's pulled out his dad's VC out of his back pocket and put it on the table and said, guys, come and help yourself, have a look at it, feel free to touch it and all that sort of thing. So it was that. Michael tells me it's worth $1.5 million, so I sort of staggered. And he also has said to us that when we do our when we have our book launch on the in April, as Michael mentioned, he's happy to drive him down, get him back from his ute and drive down for us and have him on display. So that's pretty damn good. So after the four regionals, we had two amazing shows at the MCA, the Museum of Contemporary Arts in Sydney, and they were sensational. We also, after that, went to Canberra, and then we went to Albury, which was pretty amazing too. We had Rob Kenner and Joan Kenner came along to that one. We also had the son of Albert Barella, who's one of the paintings, one of the portraits I featured, which was lovely to meet Rowan. And we also had the granddaughter of General Harry Chevelle, which was pretty amazing too. We'd met her at a couple other functions, and she sort of didn't live too far away, so she dropped in, and that was very special. That was a great show, and here we are here doing our final show. So that's what we did, but I guess I do need to thank some people, and the people who have spoken tonight have been incredible. Keith, thank you so much. This is your third show, and it should be mentioned that Keith and Flo were in Vietnam, arrived on Monday. So they were in Vietnam for a week or so, or 2 weeks, Keith. So they were good enough. And I said to them, look, I know it's a big ask. If you can't make it, feel free. If you can't make it, we'll get it. We understand. But no, they insisted on coming. So from Vietnam on Monday to Melbourne on Tuesday, and they're still here. So I think that is all. It's been fantastic, and Doug's done many shows for us, and that's been greatly appreciated. It must be very difficult for you, but you shine every time, and everyone loves you. So thank you. Michael Madden, Michael Marisky, thank you. You've done a couple of great shows for us too, and it's greatly appreciated. And the information is staggering. Your wealth, your knowledge is incredible. So thank you. I guess the biggest thank you is the Findex. I mean, not many companies would sort of go to this extent. This is not the first time we've done this. This is the second time that Findex has travelled some of my portraits around. And I do remember, and it still sticks in my head, Spiro, you did say at the Sydney show, that was the first time I actually met you, you did say it's going to be pretty hard to beat this show. I think we did. Okay. I will talk a little bit briefly. There's a couple portraits on stage which I would like to have visit, just talk about briefly. I guess Martin O'Neary is the very sad one. He's our saddest VC. Michael Mann did ask me, he said, would you be painting Martin O'Neary? And I said, mate, I don't know whether I can. It's a little bit too sad. I'll give you a little bit of background on Martin. Martin was an Irishman. He sort of travelled around Australia a bit. Was sort of basically based around Perth. He was a bit of a pacifist, so he didn't sort of raise a rifle to shoot the enemy, but wanted to do his bit. So he was, he did a lot of work as reconnaissance, but on this particular occasion, he was awarded his VC as a stretcher bearer at Pozieres. I wasn't sure how I was going to paint it. I sort of been a very dark, a black sort of painting, and I sort of thought, yes, it'll be perhaps half the face and the rest will be in darkness. His story is this: after he was awarded his VC, he came back to Perth, and the story is, I won't go into it, but he came back sort of reluctantly. But he was institutionalised, he was put in an asylum, the Claremont Asylum, and spent the last 14 years of his life in the asylum, and it was very, very sad. I get a bit emotional talking about it, but it was very sad. He died, his body just gave away. So it was very sad. So that was Martin's story. The other sad story is Hugo Throssell. Next to him, my background is basically graphic design, and it has a bit of a graphic element to it. The numbers all signify things, of course. Hugo Throssell was part of the 10th Battalion. He was the 15th VC recipient and was awarded his VC on Hill 60. So I just thought, we'll go with the numbers here. He was from a very wealthy background. His father was the first Premier after Federation of WA. I think he was one of about 13 or so children. So he was really lived a fairly privileged life, sort of good looking, strapping chap, a very good sportsman and all that sort of thing. While he was in the UK in the nursing, I think he'd been wounded, he met his wife there, Catherine Susan Pritchard, who was an award-winning author. They sort of fell in love, came back to Australia and were married. She had a very strong sort of socialist, communist sort of slant, and she influenced Hugo with his thinking towards war and things like that. And at a rally, he actually spoke out against the war. And a lot of people turned on him, and his family disowned him. He lost his job, couldn't find work. So from someone being up here, ended up down there, struggled with life. And to cut a long story short, and there is a fabulous book called The Price of Valor, written by John Hamilton. It's worth having a read. His wife was over in Russia doing a tour, and he took his service revolver out and shot himself. So another very sad story. And that was a little bit hard for me to do. I sort of started off as the shadow being in red, to sort of signify blood. And I thought, you know what, the VC caused, I think, his life with all the dramas he had. So I just had that blood drip coming down. It seems a little bit strong, but I sort of decided I would put it in there, just to sort of make a point. So they're the sadder ones. I guess the Neville House, the medic, he was our first VC from the Boer War. He was quite a distinguished chap. Born in England, was the mayor of the town of Orange, which we dropped into as one of the shows. The only Australian medic to receive a VC. So I've just put a little bit of graphic interpretation using the flag there, using the Red Cross, which is usually red at the back. I've just put a bit of orange in there just to signify that he's a commitment to the town of Orange. So he was a very distinguished chap. So he was our first, and as you already know, this was a painting that was just, it's not quite completed, it's almost there, but I was determined to have it here tonight for Doug to have a look at it. And as you would have gathered, Cameron is our last VC, so we've gone from 1 to 100. So that's really, the plan was to do a little bit of everyone, do some of the Second World War and go through, but because I'm such a World War One tragic, I just couldn't help myself. There were 64 VCs awarded during the First World War, and I would love to have painted all 64 of them, but I ended up choosing 15 or so. And you'll find outside there this. If you look at some of the stories, they're worth having a bit of a read. There are two there of Keith. The reason Keith has two is one of the smaller one of the two we have there was one that I entered in the Archibald a couple of years ago. And Flo mentioned to him a little while ago whether I would be doing one of Keith in his Vietnam uniform. And I said, well, of course I am. Of course I would, Flo. Why wouldn't I? So that's why there's two. And I'll be out there, of course, and all the speakers will be outside, so please feel free to ask us any questions you have, and we love talking about them, so that would be terrific. One thing I forgot to mention yesterday, last night, there is a function called Digger Day. We have two gentlemen here in the front. We have Fred Campbell and Rick Meehan. They're from the Nowra RSL. They're putting on this huge function on the 28th of July in Nowra. It's been something in progress for 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 years. We will have one VC from the UK, Johnson Bihari. He will be coming here. We'll have one VC from New Zealand, the only VC from New Zealand, a chap called Willy Apiata, who we've met a couple of times, and he's an amazing guy. We have Captain Limbu here. We have his son here, Banu. So Captain Limbu will be joining us at that function. And of course, Keith will be here. Doug will be there. So they're all confirmed. So it'll be a massive evening. If you are interested in attending, you talk to any of these chaps here. It'll be a very special, very unique event, and one that I look forward to. After the exhibition, these paintings will be on display at HMAS Albatross, which is in Nowra, and they'll be on display for about 5 months, and then at the end of that exhibition, they'll be at this particular show at Digger Day, and then they'll make their way home back to my place, and I'll welcome them back home. So, thank you. It's been sad, but thank you, Spindex. It's been incredible. Thank you. think Beryl might say a few words, so there you go.
I won't hold you up too long. It's remiss. It would be remiss of me not to say a few words. I mean, I wasn't planning to, nor was I last night, but this kind of thing simply blows one away. I think you'd agree. I'm not a warmonger by any stretch. I would find it hard to even shoot a rabbit. So it mystified me when I first saw George's paintings, and which Terry sort of discovered for us at Findex, and to learn that every one of them has a story, and it's usually a very sad one. You know, there's a lot of tragedy, either before or after, and the way George is very talented and the way he paints them, that the eyes say a lot, and it really resonated with me, particularly the first time when we saw the Lost Diggers exhibition, and the sadness in those eyes that were actually paintings of photographs that George reproduced as paintings. They were real, a photograph of somebody who'd been through a lot of trauma in a war setting, and you could see what they'd been through just in their eyes, and that really resonated with me. And I thought, well, it's a story that we need to make more of and tell people. That it's often forgotten. People go away, like Keith, they go away to war, and you kind of wonder what made them do that. And that, they're doing their duty for all of us, to protect our way of life. Cameron was the same. He's doing his bit for our country. And you kind of wonder, well, what made people send them to these places, and what was the purpose and the outcome? And I scratch my head. Why did we go to Iraq or Afghanistan or Vietnam? What was the purpose? There was no real purpose. But people go there because it's their duty to do these things, and they do it for all the right reasons. And it's just an amazing thing to see that the amount of camaraderie, team spirit, and loyalty to one's country and values that comes out of these things, albeit all the extreme sadness. And it's something that really certainly resonates with me, and I'm very much pro continuing to sort of tell this story to as many people as we can. I mean, we're largely a regional business, and people in the regions, small towns like the ones we've talked about, they've given up a lot too, because a small community in their area, there's a Victoria Cross winner out of a very small community, and it means a lot to these people. We want to do our part to kind of remember these things. So I just wanted to say that we're not here necessarily glorifying war, but we are here to glorify the efforts of all of these people, our last VC winner here in Cameron, and what they've done and laid down their lives. We've got our last remaining one here sitting in front of us, an amazing person, and we shouldn't forget all of that. So as a token of our appreciation, last night I think we committed to buy Michael's first 100 books as soon as they come out of print, so we can put them. Because he's given up a lot. I mean, you wonder what possesses people to do this, right? And then when you hear the story, you understand. And he's given up a lot personally to do this, to produce this work, and as the other Michael has done and his wife for many, many years, and so on and so on. These gentlemen here who are here looking after veterans' welfare, I mean, it's almost a labour of love. Well, it is a labour of love, and we respect you highly for all of your respective efforts. So what I didn't do last night, Doug, is buy some of your or Cameron's books. So tonight we're going to order a similar number so that we can get the sales ticking along for Cam's cause. And also I'd like to
also provide a $5,000 donation to CAM's cause on behalf of FinDex to keep things ticking along. And thank you so much for what you've done.
Thank you, Mr. Thank
you so much. And last but not least, this painting, I think it's this painting, George, is it?
Yes.
This painting. FinDex is acquiring this painting to hang in our Adelaide office as a memento of this whole thing and in memory of Cameron. So thank you very much.
Sarah, thank you. That's extremely generous and it's really appreciated by all of us here. Thank you very much. I'm glad I didn't sit down because I was just sitting there and I just looked across and saw my wife and I said, oh my God, I did not thank my lovely wife. So it's not only Zed, thank you Grace and Isabel for putting up with me. It's been a couple of years, so thanks guys. It's really, really appreciated. And I thank you all for coming tonight and it's been a wonderful journey for me personally. Terry and Spiro, I know you're both very passionate about this thing, and I certainly have seen it the last couple of days, especially from you, Spiro, too, and I know you've been a driving force, along with Terry, too. We've been it all started, so thank you very much. I'm thinking that maybe Doug wants to say something as well, perhaps, but we do need it wrapped up fairly quickly, guys.
Just
Terry,
it's caught me off guard. What can I say? $5,000 to CAM's cause is like $100,000 to Soldier On. We're so small. Four people, do not take one red cent. Every dollar that CAM's cause raises goes to the soldiers. So, mate, I'm just, the usual term, blowing away, mate. Now, second part of the thing is that Mr. Payne has passed the baton to me tonight to thank not only FinDex for their wonderful support, but to Mr. George Petro, it's something that probably we never take for granted, what we have, the way we live our lives, the freedom we have in this country, and we see paintings of guys that have set that standard, and our Australian soldiers today follow that standard right back from Neville, all the way through to my young son. To George, we congratulate you and we thank you very much on behalf of Keith and every other presenter that's been here. Fantastic job. Well done, mate.
Yeah.
You've got to finish it, George.
Sorry?
You have to finish it though.
Yeah, I promise I will.
I will. A final very big thank you to George and all our guests this evening for sharing their stories, their insight and their passion. I think we're all truly lucky to be here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, that does conclude the formal proceedings of tonight. Please feel welcome to stay around for further refreshments and read the stories behind each painting in the collection here this evening. As mentioned, there also is a Robert Greig VC medal on display in the museum if you're interested to have a look. And Michael's as well, but will be available. To Keith, Flo, Doug, Michael, Ross, and George, they'll all be here a little bit longer, so if you'd like to speak with them or introduce yourself, they will be hanging around. Thank you all for coming. I think it goes without saying that we appreciate your ongoing support, and we wish you, your loved ones, your families, all the very best. Have a safe and happy holidays, and please enjoy the rest of the evening. Thank you.
When the war is over, got to get away. Pack my bags to no place in no time, no day. You and I, we used each other's shoulder. Still so young, but somehow so much older.